Crew and Zitovich. I currently work for Sky as one of the hardware developers. And yeah, I'd like to present the Central Lab 2006. Alright. they have a built-in microwave and server. Now, I'd like to just go through a brief history of what Stein has been building for the last 25 years or so, 20 years, which of course was before my time, so there'll be a lot of my interpretation of it. And then talk about the current development, which is, I feel like bad because I'm probably a really bad person to work for Stein, because I'm bringing in everybody to present their project and have them talk about how nice it is. And as Stein, we don't really have something as new or up to date or as flexible. But I think it also represents a kind of a shift in our approach and also reflecting on what's going on in this scene and also focusing on what we are about. So I'll go into that in the later half of my presentation. So Michelle was able to dig out the first version of SensorLab. And it was built for his first version of the hand that was performed in 1984. And then it had these ROM chips that you could switch out and all that. So that was really the beginning of development at Skype. And then we later built this version, which is much larger. And then moved on soon after that to the more familiar version of the SensorLab, which Michelle and still quite a bit of artists use. And I think at the time for music, it was one, there wasn't really many sensor interfaces. And also what attracted a lot of people to the SensorLab was this idea that more so than expanding the musician's creativity to the interpretation of data. So it's not really about just getting data in and then applying that to simple parameters, but inviting the musicians in to the process of, like what Dan was saying about mapping, and making the interpretation part open to the musicians so they could write code. So we had a programming language called Spider, which you can edit on your computer and then upload into the SensorLab to basically deal with the data handling. So not just have a one-to-one relationship, but to have different kind of different tables or different behaviors, and kind of invite that into the idea of composition or creativity. Also, this comes from a time when the computers were really large and it was almost impossible or very inconvenient to bring your whole computer setup on stage. So the idea was to build something that you could program in your studio at home and just dump whatever settings you want onto this and bring it on stage. And so you'll have this guy attached to your body to whatever instrument you built, and then this guy will be hidden away, also connecting to a sound generator, which can be a computer or, in those days, synthesizers, which was much more convenient. However, since then, the relevance of the system has it's lost a lot of its relevance, and mainly because computers, as we all know, are so small and we do everything in it. And in most cases, the computer is both our programming environment and our sound generating engine. So it's not a really big issue to bring your laptop on stage, and also to simplify the sensor translation part to as small as it can be, and do most of the smart interpretation and coding onto the computer. And so, and that's also kind of a significant shift, I think, in this kind of whole sensor scene as well, is now we see that it's much easier for people to work on their computer and then rely on a sensor system that's much simpler, that really just takes the data in and spits it to your computer, and from there you do what you want. And so I think it's around 2003 at Stein, we started hacking joysticks, commercial joysticks. And it was a nice solution for us because we suddenly realized that, you know, we could find these sensor systems, very sturdy sensor systems off the shelf, and open them up and have a solid device that gives us analog and digital value that we need, and we could also plug it into our computers. And all we needed was some kind of software to translate whatever data that these joysticks are giving to something that we're used to, something that we could use in music. So we developed a software called Junction, which takes the HID data and remaps it to MIDI. And it was also, it also relied on a lot of the skills in the workshop we have upstairs, especially to Jorgen, who's our instrument builder. And he had the skills to, you know, really hack the joystick, open it up, look for the right connections, and then embed whatever sensors we had to those connections. So here's an example of one of his wireless joystick boards. And you know, it's probably hard to see, but inside here is one of our accelerometer boards that's very precisely mounted on there, and then with wires going in. And this is, we still use this. This was recently used for a project by John Rose, who wanted to have a ball project basically embed sensors inside these balls to use in games. And we used the system. However, the system had some of its problems because, one, the commercial market with joysticks and controllers, you know, they come and go. So if we find some joystick that we like and we figure it out, you know, next year we won't be able to find them that easily. And I think that coincided with the time that Dan was here, where we started doing research on, okay, how can we build our own little joystick boards? So this is what Dan made, I think in 2003, which is kind of the prototype of the QE board that he showed. And already you can see that, you know, there is a drastic shift from what Stein has been developing. And then after Dan left, we developed the Junction board, which Rene built. And it's already an open board. And I think that's also something representative, where for musicians, we have this black box model where we paid a certain amount of money and we didn't see what's inside, but it also gave us this insurance that we know it would work and it's solid. But then again, yeah, you invest in that. But now you see suddenly that the whole box is starting to disappear. It's not in a box anymore, these sensor systems, and they're literally boards that are inviting for the artists to invest their time they pay lesser money, but they'll invest more of their time. And so it's this new, I think it's a new approach that's inviting artists to actually learn a little bit more about the technology if they're willing to. And I personally think there is some gratification for the artists when they actually go to that level and then come back to what they do. So we've been working with this Junction board for a while, and it's great because it's solid, it's clear that the connections are clear, and it doesn't crash. You plug it in, you find it, and it works really well with our Junction software. And so since the last year that I've been here, I've been working on the next version of this. And these are some of the proto boards that I'm working on, which are much smaller. And it's very similar to what Dan's doing, and actually, I have to confess, I'm using a lot of Dan's resources that he published online. So it was a lot of help for me to look at his code and look at the advice he had, because we were using the same chip in a similar environment. But my focus with this board is that, I mean, I come at a very spoiled time where when I started electronics, there were so many options for me to choose from. And there isn't really a need for me to develop or invest my time as a, where I started as a musician and I started learning electronics because I wanted the tools I need. But a lot of times, the tools that I need are already there, so I'm always in a dilemma whether I should invest my time to develop these tools when they're out there. So I wanted to kind of reflect the workflow of the workshop we have at Stein and reflecting on what kind of projects came through the year I was here and what is Stein's strength and what it's really about. And basically at Stein we have a lot of the projects we do are custom projects for specific artists, and they're custom built by the hardware is custom built for some by somebody in the workshop, and the software is usually configured for that performance by our software developers. And because it's such a, because we have such a diverse range of projects, it didn't really make sense to make something that was generic and had all these functions of, say, a servo motor controller or, you know, a multiplexer to add extra inputs when we would only get such a project maybe once a year. And it seemed like more smarter to build just a generic, just a very simple board as small as possible that uses the basic functions of what the chip provides, and then start building from there and adding on for each project, because we never know if we're ever going to use that specific setup again. And also I wanted to, and also looking at Jorgen's work upstairs, he's always trying to make things fit in little corners and also, you know, trying to invent things. So it was, the size was kind of important, and also the layout of the board is kind of important. So if he wants to add a little capacitor to filter the noise, it should be easy. It should be small, but also easy for him to be able to place these components. So it's kind of a, I guess I'm taking kind of an opposite approach of what these proto boards are doing, is by kind of making the user-friendly environment, because I feel like, you know, that's there's so many out there and there's so many workshops, and also we don't really have the resources to compete with, you know, a very cheap and nice board and also a very intuitive interface to program the device. And I think, you know, if people come to Stein and want to use it for to learn electronics or to do workshops, I would gladly point them to these other boards. But I think what Stein does well is that we really sit down with the artist and have an intimate relationship with them and build something for them that they could bring back with them. And it's something unique with them. And I think in my perspective, that's the real strength of Stein. And also we have so much knowledge here in terms of music and what's important for musical performances. And so I think that's also something that we can reflect on. And like I said in the introduction, there's so many different protocols now other than MIDI, but I think one of the important things that we learned here is that, you know, MIDI was definitely a limitation, but it was a really great limitation for us to explore because it gave us a technical limitation that stopped a lot of the development and really focused on what we could do within that limitation in terms of expression. So, I mean, I also try to focus that not to go so much into the technical elegance of the board, but kind of find something, of course, that seems the best at that time, but also kind of stop it and work on it, look at what individual projects need. And yeah, not every musician wants to have an open board like this inside of their pieces. A lot of people just want jacks to plug into and never have that program crash during the performance and never want to look into that. And so, because I come from, you know, a background of, you know, searching the web and relying on communities and relying on other resources, I also think it's important that, and we had a discussion yesterday about the development of Lisa, whether, you know, we should make it open source and bring in other people to work on the development. And Peter said, said yesterday, well, it's great when other people can do all the work for you. And which I agree to a certain extent, but I also think whatever work that you can ask people to do, what they could do is also not what we're supposed to do here. So we should really focus on what we do. But also return back, I personally feel a really strong urge to return back to the community that I came from. So I would like to have the knowledge that we have built, and it's time to make it as a resource for people to tap into and look at, you know, some things, simple things of which cables we could use during the performance that's flexible, that has a lock to it on the connector, or what kind of interpretation of filtering the sensors that is especially useful for performative use. And I think by adding this resource to and making it accessible to a larger community really contributes to the people we attract here. And I think it'll always come back, so to our benefit. So that's kind of the approach I'm taking here at Sven. And I mean, I also think that, you know, it's really nice that now musicians can really not going from this big box to here. It's really a step of transparency when we talk about technology. It's really becoming towards to be invisible, and I think that's an ultimate goal for technology. Is that, I mean, it doesn't have to be physically invisible and tiny, but if the musicians or the user don't have to worry about it, don't have to think about it, I think that's a great step. And from my point of view, if other people have done that for us, then we can really concentrate on the musical aspects. So that's pretty much my presentation. And if anybody has any questions, can you pass it around? I'm not so proud of him, but.
Is that going to replace the junction box in the future, or is it
some development? I think it eventually will replace the junction board. And also build upon a modular model that Rex has talked about, and also Dan had talked about building extension boards for specific use.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's in the line of the development of the junction board that I'm working on.
Why do you parallel development?
Yeah.
Both like the generic interface next to this modular thing.
I mean, also Dan covered the protocol aspect pretty well, but we also use HID over USB, and I think it's really nice for what we do, because with these other protocols like OSC or serial over USB, there is a lot of strain on the user to figure out the right data structure, and I think HID, it's nice that you plug it in and you start up junction, you see a list of X, Y. It's already named for you, and that's already a huge help to the musician who's been dealing with, you know, MIDI and note and velocity and things like that. Just that step of categorizing for you. And so I think we'll stick with the HID protocol for now. I mean, I'm using the same chips as Dan, so of course you could program this to send serial. And for certain projects, we probably need to use, I think Ethernet is more suitable, but for controller applications, really, this kind of joystick model works well. Yes?
I'm really agreeing with you about this ethos of making the thing tinier and more visible and more transparent. And I work with game controllers, wireless game controllers, and Junction with a few different people, like maybe six or seven people at the same time. What I'm beginning to notice is that it's really nice to hear the sound coming from the same position as the instrument. So the next bit that needs to get more transparent is the processor and the sound generation, and then the speakers, and then everything needs to somehow come down to one space so that you can carry it around with you. And is that something? We see the Holstein sensor lab getting smaller now, but it's still going back to a central computer somewhere else,
yeah.
And then through a big PA system which is static and doesn't move and stuff.
I agree. I mean, also something we've been talking with Michelle's instrument, the hands, that if we could really embody the whole sound system into one instrument, that would be great. However, the sophistication that we're used to or that we work with the sound is so dependent on the processor speed and the programs we use. And at this point, it's not really possible to have all of that into a compact system, or it's not really in the reach of our resources, but we're always looking for that solution.
I mean, I keep wanting to start hacking Mac Minis, and I don't know how everybody feels about that, but they're getting smaller and smaller, aren't they? And cheaper and cheaper.
We actually use the Mac Minis for our installations because it's a nice box that you could hide under the table.
The biggest problem with making something small and compact and portable is the batteries. The amount of power you need is always a big problem. For loudspeakers and stuff, you need serious batteries, so your small object just can't be any smaller than the battery.
That's rare for example.
Yeah, there's a wagon behind
them. We're also looking into the performance situations where you don't need high power. So, you know, going to small rooms. And so that the price you pay is that you will not pay for that huge audience, but share it with, you know, a small group of people. Mm-hmm. And that could be a nice intermediate phase anyway, you know, to mm-hmm. go very small in terms of underground audience, and instead of thinking of big loudspeaker systems for...
Yeah.
Using a localized sound, there are also other solutions. Stan has some experience with, like, using a surround sound system where you can compute locations of sound and let it virtually appear from a certain location, which can be coupled to the physical locations of, like, gestural devices on the stage. So in that way you can separate the physical sound amplification system with the controller and still have the localization.
That's also we already have a wireless system that Renan has developed, and we are working on a kind of a modular version of that will attach to the board that I'm developing. But for now, it's really for custom projects that come to us asking for a wireless application, and we build a board for it.
We develop software and hardware for art applications, not dissimilar to Stein. Stein is focused on music, and V2 is focused on all electronic media. And essentially what we do is we develop projects for artists. Artists come with a project proposal, want to have a room with sensors all over it, and a room must know where people are, and all these kind of questions we get time and time again. And I found, as the hardware developer in V2Lab, I found that I kept having to build the same thing over and over again. Slightly different for each application, but in essence always a sensor, ID converter, some processor, and connected to a big computer that runs the rest of the installation. And from that, we started designing a modular platform that can be used in various different configurations for all sorts of applications that require sensors to be placed around the room. things that we did before, the system requirements that always return are that it should be wearable, because a lot of people want to have sensors on people that walk around the room, so no wires. And it has to be modular, because different sensors have to be plugged in, actuators have to be plugged in, and the thing has to be able to hide in a corner or in a belt pack or whatever. And because of the inherent complexity of all these different signal conversion, different types of sensors, different in-between steps that you have between the actual sensor sensing element and a bunch of numbers coming into your final application, we want to make this as easy as possible by hiding as many of these steps from the user. And in order to do that, you need to have some sort of intelligent self-configuring system where the thing just says, I have these sensors available if you want to listen to the sensor data. So we want to work with a sort of service discovery protocol, client-server architecture of data transmission, and preferably everything running real-time on a real-time operating system or anything else that's really fast. And of course, it has to be cheap, right? Because we develop these things for art projects, and art funding for art projects becomes more and more difficult every year, and there's less money available to buy expensive dedicated data loggers or sensor systems that cost thousands of dollars. So we came up with a different approach to this, and we found that we can get all the computing power we wanted in a tiny little computer, which unfortunately we didn't bring one. It's in between here. These are three circuit boards stacked together, and the main computer board is sandwiched between. I will pass it around later on so you can see what it works, how it works. And it's really the size of a stick of gum. The things are called gum sticks by the manufacturers. And believe it or not, it's this big, and it runs Linux. It's a 400 megahertz Linux machine based on an Xscale processor, the same kind of processor you find in modern PDAs and other handheld computers. And because it runs Linux, you have all the networking protocols you possibly want. It supports Wi-Fi, it supports storage on memory cards, and there's all sorts of stuff that you don't have to write anymore because it's already included in all the Linux infrastructure. It can function as a USB device, not as a USB host, but as a USB device. And it has an enormous amount of various input and output ports to which sensors and AD converters and other things can be connected. It even has a connection port for an audio codec, so the system can be expanded later with an audio stereo 44.1 in and output. And that's essentially the features of the GUM sticks, the core computer that we're using. And around this, we have to design a platform that you can just use, because the GUM sticks itself essentially has two connectors with hundreds of pins, with tiny, tiny little connector. It's not possible for a person to solder that by hand. And somehow you want to have nice connectors that you can plug stuff into. So the GUM sticks itself needs to be mounted on some kind of motherboard before it becomes even useful. We need to have a battery power supply, preferably a rechargeable battery. It needs a simple power button because the GUM stick doesn't have one, it's always on. So somehow you have to be able to switch the thing on and off. It has all these input and output ports that we can expose on different connectors for connecting different types of sensors. Serial buses, ATD converters can be added to the board. And in order to make the use connecting to this thing over the network as easy as possible, we want to use all existing internet and communication protocols. So, then we came up with this design for the 6 sensor board, which is the biggest one, this set. It's about the size of a cigarette pack. well, long cigarettes. And on top, this is the GoSticks computer. On top of the GoStick is another board that has, in this case, Ethernet and a compact flash slot with a wireless network card. And it has lots of connectors for sensors and buses and stuff. So the system now features a lithium-ion battery charger with power supply integrated on the board. It has a USB connector, so it can function as a USB device. It has a serial port with normal PC serial levels, so you can connect it directly to a PC. It has two other serial ports at low levels for connecting, for instance, Bluetooth modules or other serial I/O. It has constant modulated outputs. It has two different serial buses. It has 8 digital input-output pins. It has 8 one-wire buses. The one-wire is also a sort of serial protocol which uses two wires. That's why it's called one-wire. And it's used mainly in identification. It's a very slow protocol, but each one-wire device has a unique ID from which you can tell that particular device is a sensor module such and such, and that is a battery pack, and that is, it has 8 analog inputs in combination with a row driver, so 8 outputs, and you can combine a resistor diode sensor matrix, and you can have 64 sensors connected to this cell, to this thing, this sort of matrix, which we'll demonstrate shortly. It has 4 other inputs for with preamplifiers for high gain inputs. It has a connector for audio, and it has again a one-wire chip that monitors the battery level. So that's all crammed together on this board, and it can be expanded with various modules. That's what we're working on now, to have various ready-made sensor modules or modules that allow different kinds of sensors to be used. So far I've built a little display, which I can't demonstrate because we have not yet upgraded the driver, but I think it's a little two-color LED display about this big. A driver module for speakers and motors, an RFID reader, so it can function as a remote RFID identification unit, and a motion sensing module combining accelerometers and magnetometer for orientation and motion sensing. I try to avoid gyroscopes because they're big. But maybe I have to build a module that includes gyroscopes later on. And we're currently working on a little module that has very bright multicolor LEDs in there, so you can have a kind of color bulb that changes color. And other expansion boards that plug on top of the GoSticks include Ethernet, compact flash slots, multimedia cards or SD cards, and a tiny little low-power wireless module that plugs directly into the GoSticks. So it's not a compact flash Wi-Fi card, it's just a dedicated Wi-Fi thing. And on the software side, because this system runs Linux, we can develop any services and service discovery systems and try to make accessing the device as easy as possible. That's why we developed this, mostly Simon, developed the server application, which is dynamically configurable according to which sensors are connected, and it sort of broadcasts that it is available. It has these in the services. You can query the thing, find out what the OSC addresses of the various sensors are, the various actuators are. And you can subscribe as a client to a certain channel, and you will keep receiving OSC data from that sensor until you say, I don't want the data anymore. And various clients can get data from the same sensor, etc., etc. And in addition to that, the Linux distribution for this GoSticks device comes with secure shell servers, web server, news server, FTP server, which I forgot to mention. It even supports VPN, simple network management, you can run an SQL database on it, anything. You can install Python and Ruby, probably also Java. We haven't tried that, but it should work. It's essentially a little Linux computer that you can do anything with. And that concludes the brief introduction. Now for the fun part, Simon will demonstrate our first embedded seals object that we need to do.
Embedded in a pillow. I will not talk about the pillow because it's a whole separate project. It's actually not really much to do with that. But I will tell you something. The pillow is also a custom written program written in Python. I'm not sure if everyone can see it.
We could.
We could try. Certainly. I hope it looks good first. And the pillow is just the same kind of hardware as this is useful. And has a pressure area. It's connecting to this 64-cell resistive matrix interface. It's just anti-static foam.
You know, foam you keep chips in?
Yeah, it's carbonized and it has good resistance. And it's just all sewn into a matrix. This one is a 36-1. You can expand the two ways into columns. Furthermore, inside is a little beaker, which is nice for use to kind of keep on, although I'm not sure.
We'll keep it in the tradition here.
Exactly. Although I'm not very good sounding, so we'll probably get it.
That's okay. So what actually happens is the sensor inputs from the touch area are sent via the system open sound control to this laptop. This laptop analyzes the touch, decides on certain sound signals, sends that information back to the pillow, and the pillow actually produces the sound. So the computing doesn't happen in the pillow. It's all wireless and free and happy.
That doesn't work. There's not that much to say. I'll just.
Well, you don't have to be able to read the text on the screen. It's pretty big visually what Simon is trying to demonstrate here.
If I can get my eyes.
It's light enough.
Yeah, it's not so good actually.
Oh, that's a move.
Have you tried stages? I never use beams actually. That's why. Yeah, you just kind of.
Don't worry.
Yeah. The visualization is a bit bigger, so I don't have to read it. And you can play it. Or.
I'll get them later. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. No problem. So the nice thing of that is that you don't have to exchange, at least if you support the zero configuration interfaces because Apple. But you don't have to exchange IP numbers and port numbers anymore. This is quite a nice.
Can you speak a bit louder, please?
I can try. It's not in my nature.
I think it's the. So I switch it on then?
Yeah, you can switch it. That means it's working.
Can you see? No, you can't really. It's too small. This is the.
This is the Excel numbers. And in a minute you should see the boot time is still a bit on the long side. I'm using it there. So.
This is a Bonjour browser. It's also called Rendezvous or MDNS. It's like it's a service discovery client. It discovers services that are here. There, it could be. This is this thing, and this is the pillow. Goes to 16.
Okay, now it's
yeah,
also
it.
Appears here. It's called Seal Spring. And then we can just activate. And it's not. You can sort of press.
Oh yeah.
And it's just making sort of noises and stuff. And sort of maybe jam session.
Can everybody see this? The gray squares appearing? Appearing white again? That's the pressure
just
sensors.
If somebody wants to.
Yeah, just press it around.
Then,
Yeah.
What's first? So you don't really have to be very careful there.
No,
this was one of the applications we're using this CS4 for now.
And the little red?
It's a center of gravity of all pressures.
Okay.
And it has a bit more tendency to go to more pressed areas.
Do we hand out rewards for anybody who can play a recognizable melody?
Yeah. Anyone who can play or something is very rewarded. But it's quite some time ago I implemented this melody, so I actually even don't even recall what it actually does. It's actually also precious sensitive.
Oh, that was almost, yeah, almost recognizable.
So normally this pill also has this nice and fluffy covers.
Yeah, the pill was without its cover.
So just the stellars that just have for the calcium in this case. So, that's it.
Oh,
to show
yes. The last module that we developed for the Seal platform is a motion sensor module. Like I said, it's this little thing here. That has a three-dimensional accelerometer, three-axis accelerometer, and it has three-axis magnetometer. So it's a three-dimensional compass, and at the same time, a sort of motion sensor. And
is it ready?
Yes. The data is transmitted to my laptop wirelessly, and it arrives in maximum speed here, and open sound control. And this is the hierarchy of the address structure that thing exports. And these are the vectors. This is the vector XYZ coming from the accelerometer and from the magnetometer. When I move these things around, it changes. And in the background, we have a jitter OpenGL representation of the vectors. The green vector is the ball, and the stick is a vector, right? And it's the representation of the acceleration as observed by the sensor. The red one is the position of the orientation of the north pole as observed by the sensor. So when I start moving it around, see if I can find north. Now I'm pointing it north. North is there. Is that right? Or is this
the other? You're pointing south.
Oh, it's pointing south. Okay, that's awesome. Then this could be north.
Yeah.
There.
If it's there.
And this is the acceleration. So any fast movements registered in that. That's movement and orientation, essentially. So if you insist, I can hand this one around as well, but you have to be very careful, because if you short it out, it resets itself and stops working.
There we come.
Yeah, because you can, if you really want to play with it, you can come here and just fiddle the sensor. And see when it doesn't scream. Because I found that when demonstrating accelerometer sensors, it's all very nice for me to wobble this thing around and to have a wobbly thing on the screen, but you only feel the relationship between what you see and what you do when you wobble it yourself and watch the screen at the same time. So anybody who's really wants to see how well it works, they can come and experiment with moving the sensor around. The wires are unfortunately very short, but you can give it a try if you want.
Honeywell, HMC, what? 1500 something?
What kind of power consumption do you have?
We're not sure. It's well under 1 amp. So with a given battery, which is 2 amp hours, it lasts about 6 hours. We've tested. That depends on most power-consuming component is the wireless card. If you plug it into an Ethernet cable or USB, well, if you plug it into USB, it's powered by USB. If you power it by Ethernet, it lasts much longer than 6 hours.
But then again, if you want to use the battery, you probably
want to have it wireless. Exactly. So, but with the wireless card, 5 to 6 hours, and it's rechargeable, so you don't have to fill with batteries.
And this is the platform you're looking to keep evolving for various projects, yeah?
Yes. And the GoSticks platform, the little core, the computer core that we stuck in there, is also evolving. So there will be more powerful GoSticks relatively soon, and then we will upgrade and we'll do that.
Are you seeing the artists? How do you think it's going to look to the artists?
That's very difficult. That's actually, I know it's traditional for people to ask me questions, but I have a question for you. How do I bring this to the artist? Because it's not something you can sell as a kit. It's too difficult. You can't expect people to solder this together. It has microscopic little SMD components on there. And the boards can easily be manufactured and sold, but to populate them, it has to be mass-produced in some factory. How do you market such a thing? Because we're not interested in making profit, we're interested in getting this thing out to the artist as cheap as possible.
It's a general problem.
It's a very general problem, and I'm not sure how to deal with this problem. And
it's like a kind of a pooling system. That's maybe
you collect.
Yeah, you collect orders, and then
until you have 100, and then you
order a batch for.
But I don't want to sit at E2 on my desk and solder 100 of those things by hand.
Yeah, sure, yeah.
I've done 3, and I don't want to do any more really.
And also, you have to consider health test.
Yes.
If you start selling, then you really have a big problem, especially with a complicated thing like this, and you're 100% of the time busy with helping out people with the most.
Yeah.
But is that also really your? I mean, in a way, it sounds to me that your goal is to streamline the D2 production.
That was the first goal, primary goal.
Yeah.
So now we can use this thing over and over and over again for every artist that walks in the door and says, I want to have a sensor on the ceiling that detects how many rats are in the room.
Yeah.
Then, okay, we stick one of these things in the ceiling with a rat sensor, and there you go.
Maybe what you really need is a much less complicated version if you really want to send it out there. Essentially some sort of a docking station.
Oh, but that's already been done. I mean, the junction board and the GUI board are all so much simpler to use. And you can have a bunch of them going on. But for a wireless, like a person walking around the room with orientation and motion sensors and contact sensors and VR glasses and whatnot, it's not really an option anymore. You have to have something that is powerful enough to deal with it. And if it's powerful enough, it already becomes more complicated.
But you could also maybe think of this one having all these possibilities. And also if you could have sound synthesis and treatment on board, as that, you know, that whole application, if you would have worked together with other people who would make it into like an instrument
instead of
a tool to make other instruments, maybe this is more suitable also to try out to get an answer to your thing. I mean, the application, you know, come up with an incredible application, you know, like you have this hat and it sings all these songs and it can sample his voice and sing the same song. I have to mention something stupid, but I mean, if you would embed it into an application in an instrument that is totally portable, that is not really there at the moment, you know, not with that complexity.
We could have done that with the pillow, because what the pillow does now is it senses the touch, the laptop decides what to do and sends the information back to the pillow. The pillow could make up its own mind, it could run its sensor application and communicate directly to the beep without needing any wires.
That's what it's doing now. It's communicating with the laptop through visualization.
Oh, okay. So it stays working if we disconnect the Webhook. There you have it. It's already an embedded instrument. But
do you want to present it to the RS at all? Or is it fine for you guys to customize it in this?
I think for now, the way it's going now, what we want to do is develop the system further until we have like a complete set that covers the artist's needs, as far as we can tell at Beacon, and then maybe make it available to the general public without our, you know, having to put it together ourselves. But still, the support needs to come from somewhere. And Linux is notorious support-wise, because there's people who know, and they don't have the time to help anybody else, and the other people just don't know. And it's not like buying a book about how to program for Macintosh. That all exists, but for Linux, it's just, the information is out there, just go and find it. And then you, yes, well, and you're digging for information that should have been handed to you on a plate with the hardware, but you have to go and dig for it. That's nasty. Yeah, I'm not sure where the marketable future of this thing is, but for now we will use it as our own platform, which of course we can share with other institutes and other interested parties, and anybody wants to have a bunch of circuit boards, then we can discuss how to make them and where to get them.
Has it already been used in projects?
As so far, only
the
weird project with the pillows.
Yeah,
that's for another project in the making. For a VR helmet with the orientation sensor on it. You know, rotation go to the head. Maybe that.
Is it presented as an open source project or is it a
proprietary? That is our extension. That was the first idea. You just make it open source. With software, it's easy because you download it and you do with it what you will. But hardware, how do you make hardware open source?
Well, you publish the schematics. And
yeah, I can. But if I publish schematics, you know, the artists who have an interest in this don't want to go finding a circuit board manufacturer.
No, artists want to be able to use that code. They also want to be able to use the source code probably, but you can then have other parties like mediating between you as a designer and the artist end user to create customized solutions, more like Michelle was talking about.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
that's certainly possible. Yeah. The question is though, does everything fundamentally have to stay non-profit? Because
that's
how we started, so that's why. Yeah. But I don't want anybody else to make lots of money on it either. That's not the intention.
That's then the type of license that you choose.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But if there's no money to be made of it, who is going to build it?
Yeah. And why should you not make money from it?
Because if you do, it becomes expensive. If somebody's making money somewhere along the line, then the final price of the thing will be ridiculous.
Isn't free to in Creative Commons?
Yes, in general, but does it apply to hardware? It can apply to hardware, but we have to think about, because there's physical objects that you have to, circuit boards that you have to somehow make available. It's much more difficult than software.
We published the Crackle Box and we still sell the schematics and we still...
Using wireless modules to make wireless interfaces. As an information about my work and the place I work, it's slightly different actually to what is doing, what Shaim is doing, in the sense that I'm not working so much with kind of all in one artist that we're presented today. I'm a person that wants to get involved with interfaces and gets quite deep into sensors technology and wants to learn more about technology, how to hook up everything together. And that's part actually of the problem I'm currently facing in designing new interfaces for musical expressions. That's to say, I'm designing things, but actually I'm not so sure that the artist or composer who has the intentions of using it as really the intention of using it in the same way I'm thinking the interface. So it makes I'm actually working for people, I'm not, I'm working for and I'm not really working with. And that's kind of big difference in designing. So my initial wish in designing interfaces was to make a kind of general platform, such as the Ipsen lab that was presented this morning. This is a separating functions, communication layer on one board, and then daughter boards or satellite boards to separate CPU power on different boards and make the communication between the boards possible, so that you can keep the communication layer board like a noisy board, you can keep using it, and then design only the relay part, PWM part, whatever, and establishing a protocol for making the boards communicating. Well, for wireless it's a bit different, because what you need is basically something which is embedded wearable with batteries. So the notion of having an interface that is reusable is a little bit different, in the sense that you might accept more easier to have something new designed, because it's responding to something very specific to free gesture and wearable and costume fabric or whatever. So the problem in using wireless modules is, well, if you go back like 10 years before, there were those tiny little modules made by, for instance, Random Matrix, Aurel, Bigbox, and the kind of company who made those basically garage door automation, you know, to make a remote control, to control a very simple process like, you know, wireless doorbell or whatever. And those were very useful for media artists that wanted to experiment a wireless interface, like making a globe with some bending sensors or that kind of controller. But then what happens when you need your two hands? Okay, I need a second module. Okay, but then there are FCC regulations in my country, so I cannot use all the frequency I would love to. Of course, if I'm an electronic engineer, I might be able to tweak, modify the existing module, or I might build my own emitter, wireless emitter, and maybe if it's too powerful because I didn't pay attention to the power I'm sending, I will have the cops coming and this happened to me. So this is the first problem. Then there is autonomy. The autonomy problem is stamina of your module. If you want it to be used, okay, during performance is one thing, but then there is all the reusing process that might consume either a lot of batteries or a lot of time to swap batteries, paying probably someone to think about recharging the batteries for you, and it's a kind of trouble. Of course, there is the quality of sensor sampling. It means sample rate, it means resolution. And also reliability, which is probably the word that I cannot pronounce today. Meaning that making something wireless is something. I mean, you cut the wire, and then problems start. Because you have to make sure that the data that you're sending is arriving properly to the destination. So you have to create error-free protocol with checksums and many things to make sure that even if you have a problem, either you ignore the data or you have to the data to be retransmitted. So I've been doing this by hand for a while, using those mono frequency channels, little modules, and then creating myself the protocol with an exchange in a bidirectional way to make sure that the data was behaving properly and was properly sent to the destination. But of course it reduces the useful traffic, and it's a real problem to have a good sample rate for the data. I mean, having something very reliable but running at 5 Hertz per sensor is useless. I mean, you better have a long cable with flexible wires, and it's much better. So how to solve the problem of having multiple emitters on a stage, because it was the main part of my research over the past 4 years. I hope I'm not going to push open doors, because probably most of you know a lot about radio frequency. latency techniques, or actually I don't know, but just let me know if it's like public knowledge what I'm saying. So basically, if you want to have a single receiver and different emitters on stage, it can be your two hands, it can be different people on stage, then you need a client server architecture so that you might be able to distinguish the different sources and eventually address a certain client and make sure that it's not confusing between A and B or C. So there are different techniques to do this. You can do what is called polling. It means that you're going to interrogate the different emitters over time. And to do this, you have to send an order to the destination, make sure that the destination understood properly, and then the client is going to send the data back. But the polling system and rolling over time, interrogating the different slaves, is taking time, and this is not always the way to have good results. Like the board that was presented just before, you can have peer-to-peer connections, meaning that the device themselves can talk to each other, and at the same time can maybe send broadcast frames so that there is a master receiving all the traffic to do something. You have the simple way to go, which is many receivers and one transmitter, but this is not really interesting. I mean, this is FM radio broadcast. It's pretty easy to do, and this is probably not the most useful way to go when you're on stage and you have different participants to a performance. That's exactly the opposite of the first topology that I presented. So basically, if you want to solve this problem of having multiple senders on the same network on the same place, either you need different frequency channels, and this is the way to go. This is what I did in the past. I bought some modules from the United States to have a different frequency. I bought modules from the UK so that I have like three different systems, and I can have three people on stage, or my two hands plus someone else or whatever. But then there's always an artist coming with all the pressure and saying, okay, I would like to do four.
Yeah.
So what can I do? So this solution is possible, but it's pretty limited to the number of channels that you can have, depending on the regulation, the local regulation of the country. And I don't know a lot of countries in which you can have the full spectrum of FM available to do your stuff. Of course, it depends on the power that you send. If you reduce the power to less than 1 milliwatt, no one will know. But then you will have the problem that the spectrum might be occupied by very powerful transmitters, and you might be aware that during concerts, if you want to be sure to be able to use all your wireless microphones during a rock concert, then you will have that white noise generator and that wide spectrum, very powerful transmitter, and you put some white noise on it, and you destroy all the expectation of other people to use this spectrum so that the concert goes well. So you don't have any interest that you will be able to use the spectrum zone or the channel that you were thinking about. Especially when you travel, this is the second problem. So the second topology is to have a concentration system, and concentrating the data on the same frequency channel means sharing the bandwidth and sharing the channel. So it's exactly when you're talking with someone, with like during the round table, for instance, and if someone wants to talk, he has to ask for time slice so that you can properly say what you want to say. So doing this arbitrary decision can be by a master, which is doing some polling, like I said before, but this is not the most efficient way, because maybe you're going to propose a speaking time to someone who has nothing to say. So you will waste time proposing someone, especially if you have a lot of people. If you spend your time, yeah, you have something to say, no, yeah, you have or something to say about this. And especially because you're asking the question and you have to wait for a potential answer. And if, for instance, the person has fallen asleep, you might wait a certain amount of time before knowing that, unfortunately, the person is not going to answer and you're wasting time. So the solution that was, we'll skip that and go to, yes, I will come back to the response. The solution that was found by Wi-Fi or Bluetooth, that kind of protocol, and so ZigBee now, is to have a statistical time slice distribution for allowing the station or the client to speak on the same channel. Of course, having a frequency separation between the two different several channels is also a solution. But I thought at a certain moment, if you arrive in an area, in a room like here, we have a Wi-Fi network, I cannot ask this place to cut up the router and suppress the wireless connection. So I have to adapt myself and go on another channel. So being on different channel is not always possible because the spectrum might be occupied. And if I want to be able to emit on the same channel that the Studio 3 SSID network here, it has to be possible. So IEEE created this standard called 802.11, which is also known as Wi-Fi, but Wi-Fi is not the standard. Wi-Fi is the certification that it's compliant to the standard, the IEEE standard. And it's using something very smart. It's using collision avoidance protocol, meaning that it's different than wired internet here, because wired internet online is using collision detection. It means that, okay, problems might happen, will happen, and we'll try to solve who didn't properly receive the data because there were two packets in collision. You cannot do this wireless because things are not connected, so you don't know what happened in the air. Yeah, it's a kind of open door, but it's very obvious what I said. But when you think about it, it's an interesting problem. You don't know how you're going to resolve the collision. So if you don't want to resolve it, you have to avoid it. So this is the meaning of this acronym CSNACA, and it means that you are working on a carrier, let's say frequency radio channel, and on which you're going to avoid collisions, and it means that you have to listen before transmit. So you have to make sure that nobody is talking on the line before trying to speak. But if you do this with this simple algorithm, like I'm listening, it's free, I go, it doesn't work, because you might have some synchronous looping system. You will have a kind of beat on the network where some clients will always have the opportunity to talk because they are in a synchronous process with always the same kind of timing. So they won't be able to leave some time slices for other people who have never the possibility to talk. So this is why they had some statistical delays in the communication process. That's to say that first you listen to the carrier, and if it's free, you wait a random delay within some certain boundaries to make sure that next time you will, just after this delay, you listen again, and if it's free, maybe you go. And this way, there is a kind of chaotic but automatically arranged possibility to talk for each client within a certain bandwidth, of course. If you have too many people trying to talk at the same time, even if you have this random thing, you will have some limitation, and the limitation is basically the limitation of the Wi-Fi for 802.11b. It's 11 megabit per second, in which you have, of course, the wireless protocol thing. But this is basically the data rate. Maybe you have 10 megabits per second available for sending data, and if you try to send more, you will be either limiting the number of stations on the same access point or capacity on the same network, or you have you will have to reduce the amount of data you're sending, or the sampling rate you're using. I won't talk too much about Bluetooth. I had actually a pretty bad experience with Bluetooth trying to properly send data to the computer. It's it doesn't mean that it's a stupid solution. This is not what I'm saying. I mean, you can do a lot of things with Bluetooth in the sense that it's ready-made technology. It exists in body shapes, OEM modules. You can add a cellular earphone, Bluetooth earphone to make a wireless microphone or wireless ear monitor. You can do many things with Bluetooth, but the main problem is latency and the stability of the data rate, because Bluetooth can fly much faster than the speed at which you're sending data to the module, which is often using a serial port. And even if you're talking to the module at 100,000 bit per second, Bluetooth will fly to the computer much faster than this. So it's waiting to gather enough information before sending a packet in one burst. So it means that the receiver will get all the data packed into a big packet, which is probably the accumulation of several frames, and you totally lose the initial timing of the sensors that were chopped at a very accurate sample rate, like one millisecond per sensor, or maybe shorter. So when it comes to the computer, you will have, in, for instance, 2 milliseconds I send, for instance, 1,000 values, and if you send this to max MSP, it's below the time resolution of the software to be able to unpack everything. So it will work like you're having data at a rate of, I don't know, not 10 hertz, but 100 hertz, while it's been sampled at 1 kilohertz. So it's pretty strange, because when you monitor this on the receiver, if you have a Bluetooth receiver on which you can have a look on it with an oscilloscope, you can see that the timing has been destroyed, but nothing is missing in the packet. All the data are here. But then when it goes to the API, as in Windows or Macintosh or and finally goes into Max MSP, the timing between two informations is too short, so they can be unpacked properly and some data are dropped. So when I had this problem of iPhone 4 and I have only three frequency channels for an interface, I decided to experiment Wi-Fi, and I knew that people, of course, would like to have not only four, maybe more and more station on stage or in the museum, for instance. Like you want to make some interactive installation within the museum, you might give each visitor a box with Wi-Fi and sensors, and they will go inside and participate to the installation. And at the same time, I wanted the system to be very fast. That's to say, as close as possible to sending in 1 millisecond, let's say, 16 sensors on 16 bit. So I had a look, of course, to the Linux drivers that I could find on the internet, or like Orinoco or Prisp drivers. And when I had a look to the code, I saw so many data structures that you had to handle just to be able to make a simple connection with the card. That I said, okay, it's exactly your project with the pillow and the gum stick board. It means that if you have a board that runs Linux, then it's okay, because you can program, modify packages in C and then put it back to the gum stick board and have something that works. But if you want to go below the milliseconds to dialogue with the card, maybe you have to write it yourself. So that's what I did. I chose a Wi-Fi card from Linksys. I will go back to this after. And I decided to experiment with a single microcontroller, which is basically running at 10 megahertz. talk with the card at low level, start putting some packets inside, formatting the packets, and then I wrote a custom UDP IP stack, which is not totally, this is not a complete stack, and of course, you can do telnet on this. But basically, it's responding to being all the basic Ethernet things that you're supposed to answer to. And it does all the digitizing of so 16 inputs and on 16 bits sensors. So you have two connectors. There's one here and one here for 8 inputs each. And it's formatting the IP packet. I mean, it does Ethernet, IP, UDP, OSC with checksums and all this stuff. And then put this into the card and send it out over OSC. And it has also a USB serial port for the configuration. So there is a small application version in Max MSP just to change the basic parameters like the SSID and stuff. Initially, I wanted the thing to be configurable by telnet or using a configuration file or something like this. And I talked with my system administrator and said, okay, if you want to use this yourself, then it's probably okay. But if you want to offer this to the community, then it's really going to be a problem to ask people to edit a kind of strange text file with strange name parameters and stuff. So I decided anyway to go through a virtual serial port on USB, which is also not my favorite way to go for exchanging data with Max MSP, but that was practical because I can have drivers with the TDI chip. It works on Macintosh and PC. So I ended up with a Wise box, which is this little pocket-sized box with the batteries, which has 2.5 hours autonomy, basically, which is okay for a concert, but still a problem for rehearsing, because it's using a lot of batteries, so you have to swap them. But I made some modifications so that you can build your own 5 AAA rechargeable battery pack with a recharge port, and using a radio command charger with delta peak detection, then you can charge a Wise box within less than 1 hour, and it's very fast. So of course, if you have two of them, you can eventually swap the back if you want to remove the back. So plenty of solutions to get rid of the autonomy problem. But of course, this is still using a Wi-Fi card that draws. It's close to I think it's 290 milliamps. And the whole system, the whole box is drawing 300. So I don't have a lot of current flowing in the box itself. It all goes to the Wi-Fi card. So So the advantage of Wi-Fi, of course, is that you have an incredible range, and you can distribute an architecture and stage. We're working also with Linksys routers that you can dispatch on stage and make sure that they can be set up in WDS, which is Wide Distribution System, and make sure that there is always the best communication quality between the box and the shortest available access points. This is all automatic. And without radio regulation and channels, it's using the ISM band, which is industrial and medical band, I think, which is the 2.4 gigahertz band. It's been regulated worldwide. It means that, of course, you can use Wi-Fi, not all the spectrum, it depends a little bit on the countries, but you can have the whole, almost all the channels available around the world. So it means that you can arrive in a country or in a place and see that eventually this channel is not available, and you simply switch your router and put it to another channel, and then you're coming. Also, there are some 3D software that can be used for analyzing the spectrum and see if there are some close access points that are sending high power signals with high data rate and stuff, so you can quickly choose just by looking at the occupation of the spectrum which channel is going to be the best. And then there is the collision avoidance system and listen before transmit that makes sure that anyway you won't have big problems of communication, because if your neighbor is simply, you know, browsing the web, not even listening MP3 by internet, then, you know, browsing web pages is not big data rate. So you will have plenty of time on the bandwidth to be able to sense your data. Maybe the timing is going to be slightly fluctuant, but you will be able to form the use. The nice thing also is that you can use the system in ad hoc mode directly with the computer. So it means that the computer is going to create the network, and then the wise box is going to find its way to the computer. And if you want to go on stage, then you can have several wise boxes attached to an access point, and another set of two wise boxes attached to another access point, different channel, different SSID name, and the two access points are connected by the LAN, so they can eventually even talk together if it's required. I've been using this architecture at the very beginning, but it's true that the ad hoc mode is not dedicated to have multiple senders to the computer. This is more the infrastructure mode. So it's much better to have this organization for the wise box. Also, the thing is that in the case of ad hoc, the computer is handling the reception of Wi-Fi and has to deal with the specific headers of Wi-Fi. While in the infrastructure mode, then you have all the work done by the router, which is something totally autonomous, which is receiving and processing the packets and then rerouting it to the computer using a classic LAN cable, which can be 100 meters long. And you make sure that the computer doesn't have to think about Wi-Fi stuff. It's simply processing IP stuff. And we discovered that it's not a question of reliability, but it takes actually less CPU power to have the access point handling all the concentration of the wise boxes and distributing it to the computer. And this is what I said before, you can have the different access points connected to the cloud and then having the thing getting to the computer using that. Maybe what I can show quickly is a very simple reception of the wise box. Or maybe you will play with it afterwards. So in this case, it took like 5 seconds to get the connection, because it has to wake up the SSID profile on my computer, so that my little software from Intel here remembers that the SSID my computer is in the profile, so since the wise box is popping out, it's going to open the connection for it. So there are 5 seconds to discover it, but in the case of using a router, it's almost limited. I mean, you power the wise box, it has a kind of blinking process with colors, which has been a problem with Daltonian people. I have two customers that have the problem of distinguishing the colors, and it's of course especially between green and red, which is the most they send me an email, they call me on the phone, and they say, okay, is it blinking this way? What color? I don't know. I have to ask my wife about the color. So it goes like checking the battery, making sure that it's not too high, that finding the SSID, and now it's getting to ARP to find the destination address, and then it sends out the data directly. if the port is not open, then it will link between I think orange and green, just to say that the port is not open, and then as soon as the UDP receive objects or whatever object that you use to receive the data is instantiated, then the data UDP receive. So in this case, it's working at 5 milliseconds, but it can go down to 3 milliseconds actually for sending the 16 data. It doesn't mean that you have one data after the other with 3 milliseconds between the two. It's a full packet of 16 sensors sent every 3 milliseconds in this case. So we've been using those for dance mainly, but also I had some artists that wanted to use it for laptop performance, because this is quite practical to have this in the belt. Now, I would say, but we'll probably talk about this during the round table, that not a lot of people at Gekham have used it. Just because most of the concerts that are created at Gekham, finally it's a relationship between a composer with a certain idea of music, who's writing a piece, and actually is kind of interested by adding a new toy in the piece because it's fun. And the piece will be played by an instrumentalist who hasn't been involved into the project. And this instrumentalist just wants to keep playing the violin just the way he learned. So it's pretty difficult to convince the instrumentalist that he has to wear this. And the last concert I've seen, he didn't even want to have this on the belt. So we had that marvelous scenography with the violin player and the score stand with the wise box standing here and the wire and the kind of like this. So I finally said, okay, you know that it might turn wrong if the box fell or whatever. So you have to convince the instrumentalist to wear it. So it leads us to another part of the debate, but this is that, it's difficult to integrate technology in such a kind of box in an artistic project in which the persons are not been convinced about the use, or they just don't want to change their habits. I mean, technology is something more. So that what has been said before, the main clue is not, I don't think it's about getting new skills. It's a matter of time, after all. That's to say that if you want to keep your habits about making a piece or an artistic project, and you want, for instance, music and video and technology with sensors, then you need somehow some time to work on the different things. This is something more. This is not a fantastic solution that simplifies everything. I mean, using this on stage is a bunch of problems. It's not something that is going to solve everything. So you need some more time to, of course, practice, because if you design a new instrument, you need some practice. And it's not possible, to my opinion, to create an artistic project with a certain approach to the technology without having the time which is necessary to work with it. But okay, this is something else. So I added a few pieces of the box again. Just to show you that it's also possible to talk to the box. I mean, when you have like 5 dancers on stage and you're not sure who's who because they exactly have the same costume and who the same. I made, for instance, these practical things I've made and face. So you have this blinking command that, okay, you're trying to figure out in the dark who is who, and say, okay, I'm going to check what's work number one. Sarah, where are you? Okay. So I won't call this device a platform, because it's not. I mean, it's a device that has been designed and programmed so that it can digitize data with a high resolution and high sample rate, but it can also do a few things else. The first thing is that I'm currently trying to upgrade the box so that it's compliant with Bonjour and Rendezvous, so that you can have a schema discovery of the box. We already programmed some Bonjour within MaxMSP, so this is an object that you can download from your CAM, which is called OSC Bonjour. And so it means that if you have a hardware that talks Bonjour, or even two computers that are declaring some open sample control service, then it's being seen automatically between the two. So you plug the computers together, and as soon as you've done that, you have a refresh of the menu, and you see that the computer next door has something to transmit in port 1000, and it's called sensor box. The second thing I'm doing for the moment with the white box is using it for geolocation using the radio signal strength that is received from the beacon frames sent by the access points. So I initially wanted to have a system in which I send from the computer to the white box some order to ping the different access points that were in WDS. But it doesn't work because since the way WDS is done is that you choose a specific access point which is giving you the best quality of transmission. So when you ping from the white box pings an access point, actually it will go through always the same access point. We link the relay to the other ones. So it means that you cannot have different signal strength, like you were interrogating directly the access point. So I finally discovered, looking into the sources and also in the documentation, driver documentation that I was able to get from Interseal, which is the manufacturer of the chipset which is inside, that some specific commands for the Wi-Fi cards allows you to make a scan of the available access points. And then you get the beacon frames from the different access points that they don't have to be on the same network, but it can be a totally different network. Actually, you simply have the access point as a beacon. It's not even connected to the rest of the networks, meaning that you have a specific router which is your link to the computer using LAN from the access point to the computer. And then you have some different access points spread over the stage, and you use them just for beaconing their SSID name, and of course you get the signal strength in this case. So what we are doing at the moment is using the MNM library. MNM standing for music is not mapping. But this is a joke. I mean, this is controversial stuff. To avoid having a strange calibration process in which you have to specify the distance between the access points so that you can have a Cartesian distribution on the stage, we simply have a calibration system using the MATMAP objects, and it means that you go at a certain location of the stage, and on your computer you say, okay, I'm here, you memorize it, you make eventually several measurements by spinning around yourself just to give different orientation of the box, and you pass through all the stage like 1 meter between two positions, 5 minutes, and then you click calibrate, and the system tries to reverse all the mathematical law between the different routers. So the routers can be placed in various places. They don't have to be right in line. So this is the groundwork. Now about the new things we've done is this little tiny module, which is based on a Maxstream EXB wireless transmitter. So it's more simpler because Yeah, at the time we started working on WiseBlocks, I mean, ZigBee was not so standard at the time, and we couldn't find some components and ready-made boards at the time. So we made this, but perfectly knowing that we will have to go very deep into Wi-Fi just to be able to send a very simple information, which is the sensor, the sensors that have been digitized. And, you know, it's quite a pain because you have to calculate a lot of things just to be able to send data. You have to be able to communicate with the card and act a lot. ZigBee has been designed exactly to suppress this kind of problems, that's to say, to have a very simple stack just for sending. But at the same time, having the collision avoidance and listen before transmit system. So this is the combination between the two advantages of having multiple stations on a single frequency channel or multiple channels, and making sure that the data is probably getting to the destination, collision avoidance, checksums, and so on. So you have 16 channels, you have more channels than Wi-Fi because the bandwidth is not the same. Of course, this is slower. You don't have the same data rate that the Wi-Fi, but it can be implemented with a simple RF232 with a microcontroller, and Maxstream even have released some special firmware because there is a microcontroller inside the transmission chip, and you can directly hook up the sensors without the need to put a microcontroller on it, and it will be a pocket-sized digitizer which is designed with battery, which gives 3 hours of autonomy. Maybe I have just a very fast demo I can do with it, just to show you also the recognition system that we're developing at the moment, which is based on hidden Markov models. So this is a statistical method to recognize gesture, free gesture. And Frederic de Gracois made a new patch for me.